We're in this new series of messages on how small things in our life teach us lessons that make a difference when the big issues come. And Chris talked to us last week about young David, and before he met Goliath, he had a lot of issues in the in his shepherding experiences, attacked by wild animals, things like that, which would be big to me, but they were small in contrast, I guess. And so today, I want us to look at another character in the Bible, Elijah, who, unless you think, well, that's really old, different, and not like us, actually, in James chapter 5 in the New Testament, it said Elijah was a person just like us. So I thought, well, we should learn a little bit about life from him, since he's just like us in every way. So his story is in 1 Kings, which is way back at towards the beginning of the Bible, and 1 Kings chapter 17. I'm going to try and read this without falling over with my vertigo. And to give you a little background on this, there's his story weaves in with a king named Ahab. Ahab, well, all the kings, it says in 1 Kings, it's all about the kings of Israel. And they were all bad, one after another, were bad and bad and bad. And then they get to Ahab, and it says he was more evil than all the others before him. It's like, we're like the culmination of bad leadership. And it's in this context that Elijah emerges. So in chapter 17 it says, now Elijah, he was a Tishbite, that's tells you something, from Tishba. So in Gilead, goes to the king, this evil monster king, goes to Ahab and says to Ahab, the Lord, the God of Israel lives, whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain in the next few years, unless I say so. That's a pretty bold thing to say. And in verse 2, then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, leave here, get out, turn eastward and hide in the Kereth ravine, east of the Jordan, and you'll drink from a brook that I ordered the ravens to feed you there. So he did what the Lord had told him. He went eastward to the Kereth ravine, east of Jordan, and he stayed there. And ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. In verse 7, sometime later, the brook dried up. So Lord, teach us about our lives from this person who is just like us in every way, you say. And what do we do when the brooks in our life dry up? And what does that mean for us? And how do we follow you in the midst of our real lives? That's our prayer in Jesus' name. Okay, so we're here at the beginning of this new year, right? 2017, am I right?
Yeah.
They said there'd be no math on the test. But so I like the new year, but I don't like New Year's Eve. My whole life I've been this way, and I was thinking about this. Why is that, that I dread New Year's Eve, but I really like the new year? I think it's because I'm one of those people who really likes new beginnings. I like starting fresh. I like the idea of, okay, here we go, something new and different, adventure, something like that. The problem is that I'm kind of a spiritual hoarder, emotional hoarder. And so I like new beginnings, but I don't like the saying goodbye to the old. And New Year's Eve is all about, you know, oh, let go of the old. No, let's see what's coming. And so I don't really like that, because I like to carry everything with me into the new adventure, which kind of keeps it kind of the same, really. It doesn't seem that new, really. But as we look at the changes in our life, how do we handle letting go of things and moving forward? How do we go on a new adventure without being a hoarder and without carrying everything with us? And I think Elijah has some lessons for us in this. Now, I grew up in Sunday school after we got back from Africa, and we're living in LA area. and I was going to Sunday school, and I got some ideas in my head that have been really hard to get out. And one of them is, if you're trusting God, if you're following God, then bad things don't happen to you. They happen to bad people, or at least people who weren't Presbyterian. That was my background. So if you're not Presbyterian, bad things can happen to you. Baptists get hurt, you know, that kind of thing. But not us. And if you are having tough times, it's probably because you don't have enough faith. And so if somebody around you is having tough times, all you have to do is suspect that they're probably off track and try and figure out what their problems are, you know. Because otherwise, why would they be struggling? Well, that was a misconception. I've been wrong about that. The other thing is that when bad things happen, it's usually a sign that God's abandoned us. And I carried that around for a long time. And I think that's a misconception. But looking at this passage about Elijah, a few things that went on there. First of all, Elijah went to the king, but it doesn't say that God said, go to the king and here's what you're supposed to say to him. Don't you think that, you know, before we do anything, we should get a word from the Lord that says, this is what you ought to do, this is my will for you, here's how it's going to happen, and just wait until you're clear and certain that this is what God wants you to do, and then step out and do it, right? That's the way a lot of Christians operate. That's the way I've operated at times. I'm not going to do anything until I'm really sure that God's in this. Here, we find something totally different. He acted first, and then in verse 2, it says, the word of the Lord came to him. So he actually went and confronted the king, and maybe he'd been reading scripture and looking at what's going on in the world around him and made some conclusions that, you know, this is going to be bad. And so he went and told the king about it. Then God's word comes to him and says, okay, get out of there, run, hide. Go east. And that seems like it's almost backwards from the way most of us operate. But he had courage and he went and did it, and then God's word came to him after he'd already acted. Now, have you noticed that at New Year's, everybody likes to make their predictions, what's going to happen? I love the National Choir in January. Because nobody even cares about Nostradamus except the National Choir in January. Every year they always have, you know, okay, here's what's going to happen. They never have the issue that says, okay, here's what we predicted last January and here's what really happened. They don't publish that. And everybody's thrown away their choir, so they don't know that nothing actually happened that they said would happen. Now, this happens in a lot of different areas of life, and one of them is in the investment world. And I like at the end of the year, all these different people who have columns and blogs and stuff on investing will always say, here's my number one stock choice for 2017. And there's a bunch of these articles out there. And here's the one stock that you ought to get. So I was looking around at these, and everybody had a little different thing. But there was one, and the title of his column was, I'm No Nostradamus. And I thought, well, I got to read that one. And he said, I've never seen this before. He went through and he said, okay, I made 5 predictions last year at this time. And here's what happened. I was wrong every single one of them. None of what I said was happened. Every recommendation for a stock I made went the other way. If you followed me, you lost it all. I thought, wow, this guy is honest. And then he said, now here's my pick for 2017. This is where you ought to put all your money. No, 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 no. You'd have to be crazy to invest like that, you know, and put money in that. Well, I bought some. Yeah, just to be on the safe side, you know, in case, you know, the blind pig finds a truffle every once in a while. Maybe, you know, this has got to work out. But I thought, how honest that he said, every single thing I said last year was wrong. Now, here's what you got to do. I was at 180 and went, okay, let's try it. How much can you lose? We'll find out. But so Elijah went to the king without God telling him to go to the king, without God saying this is what's going to happen. He just went and went, this is what I think is going on here, and this is going to happen, and it's going to be a bad drought in this land until I say so. And then the rain started. And then God's word came to him and said, okay, here's what you need to do. Get out of there. Go, hide, ravine. There'll be a little brook there. You'll have some water while everybody else is dried up. And there's going to be some ravens that come, and you can yell at them, and they'll drop the food out of their beaks, I guess. And you pick it up and eat every morning, every evening. That's where your life is right now. And so he goes. And he finds that to be true. And he's taken care of. Just like God said. Now, you probably thought, Lord, you couldn't have found a river. It had to be a little brook. But that's okay. It was just him hiding out. He was safe. The whole country's a mess. He's okay. And birds just keep coming back because there's a little brook there. So the birds keep coming back and they drop food for their beaks. So he's okay. Everything's great. Now, in Sunday school, when I heard this story, we had a flannel graph, flannel board, remember that? Little velvety thing, and they'd put little pictures on it. I remember the story of Elijah, and then the brook, and everything, and the lesson was, see, God's going to take care of you. You can trust God, he's going to take care of you. And when they were kind of crows, you know, but the ravens, and the little brook, and Elijah was there, and everything was great, and then that was the end of Sunday school. They never said the verse number 7. They never told us that. Sometime later, the brook dried up. Now, what happens when you're right where God wants you to be? You're doing exactly what God wants you to do. He's providing for you morning and evening, and everything's taken care of, and you're safe, safely hidden. And the king and all his people are probably looking for you to kill you or whatever. And you're safe. You're protected. You're going, Lord, thank you. You have provided for me. And then it stops. Now, it probably didn't stop at once. It probably was, you know, a brook. And then it was a little stream. And then it was a trickle. And he's going, okay, Lord, you know, you're okay. And then pretty soon it's nothing. What do you do now? Now, I think that in our lives, there are lots of times when the stream dries up. And it doesn't mean that God's forgotten us. And it doesn't mean that we're out of God's will. And it doesn't mean that we've misunderstood or that we're in the wrong place. It's just that in life, streams dry up. In a drought. You run out of water. All those things. And so so Elijah is being faithful where God told him to be, being provided for and taken care of by God, and then everything ends. Now we're at a crisis point. What happens when our stream dries up? What happens when what we've been relying on isn't there anymore? What happens when relationship ends, or job ends, or something happens, or health goes away? There's a couple of things that happen. One is that when this occurs, we pay attention more intently. We're more open to new info. I think Elijah, when that stream dried up, he was really open to, God, you got something for me now? What you said was going to happen was great and everything, and it's ended. What is there for me now? And I think he was listening for God's word in a whole new level at that point. The other thing that happens is that when the stream dries up, we think that it's about us because we're so aware of our situation. Have you ever gone through a loss or something like that and you feel like, wow, look at this loss I'm going through. Look at this problem I'm going through. Look at how this is. And we don't realize, this is really important, the change that we're about to go through is not about us. It may be the answer to somebody else's prayer. What you're going through may be the answer to the prayer of someone else. For example, sometime later the brook dried up because there was no rain in the land, obviously. Then the word of the Lord came to him, go at once to Zarephath and Sidon and stay there. I've commanded a widow in that place to supply you with food. So he went. All of a sudden there's a whole new scenario. I believe Elijah would never have gone to the city. He's a wanted man, for one. And things aren't that good in the city. Except that his situation ended. And he really didn't have an option. So he goes to the city where he's supposed to, you know, all he knows is there's a widow there that I'm sending you to, and she's going to provide for you. Now, if it was me, this is the way I think, I'd go, woohoo! Oh, yeah! This is so great! Some rich widow who's inherited all this money and has this big house and servants and probably a cook, you know, all that stuff. And she's going to provide for me, finally, because I've been so faithful here. Right? I mean, that's natural for me. Well, maybe not for you. Think that's about selfish. Well, okay. So he goes probably thinking, I'm going to be living large. This is so great. And so he gets to the, goes to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called out to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so I can get something to drink? Kind of chauvinistic, really. Kind of selfish. Because he's on his way to the big house to live large. Give me a little water, I can have a drink. And as she was going to get it, he said, oh, and bring me a piece of bread, too, to dip in the water. This is really cool. And then she replies, well, surely as the Lord, your God, lives, I don't have any bread. I've only got a handful of flour in the jar, a little oil in the jug, and I'm gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son so we can eat it and die. I just can't imagine how disappointed Elijah was. I didn't find the rich widow. I found a single mom who was out of everything. That's what God intended for me. Well, that leads to a whole new experience for him. With a single mom, her son, and all these things. And like Chris said last week about David, how the preparation that he went through, the experiences he had, mattered when he got into a new challenge. We find in this chapter in 1 Kings that Elijah is unimpressed by the struggles that the single mom's going through. He's unimpressed with the problems with the son. He's unimpressed with their near-death experiences. It doesn't bother him. And I thought, why? Why isn't he panicky or saying, Lord, you sent me to the wrong house? You know, I think it's because for couple of years, he had to sit in the ravine and go, wow, I hope those crows come back tonight, because I got nothing. And then they do, and he goes, wow, good, got through the night. I hope they come back in the morning. Hope they remember
you know, to do that.
Every morning and every evening for a couple of years, he sat there alone and waited to see if God would provide as he said he would. Now, you've seen God provide in your life as he said he would. Sometimes it's not the way you want it, or the timing you want, or the amount you want, whatever it is, but you've seen God take care of you through a lot of different issues. And I know that because I know you. Maybe that could give us the confidence to go forward into new situations and not panic. And not wonder, but go alert. Do here in this house with this single mom and her kid what you did for me sitting by the stream. Provide for them. Take care of us. Because that's what you promised to do. Now, I wonder what it'd be like this year, 2017, to not be wondering if God's going to come through, but actually live in a certain amount of confidence. We belong to God. He's going to provide for us. We can trust him. And let's look and see how God does it. Not if he will, but how he'll do it. How will we recognize the answer that God brings? Elijah's personal problem, which was the stream dried up, his dry point, his life, was a problem for him. But for this single mom and her kid, who were at the end of their resources, that was actually the answer to their prayer. And if you look later on in the chapter, it goes through a lot of things. And she ends up saying, I know you're a man of God. I know that the word of the Lord is true. Because she's seen it. She's experienced it. And what saved her and her son began when Elijah realized life as he knew it was over. But God wasn't done with him. You ever get to a point where you wonder, is God done with me? Is God finished with me? Is there something more? Is there something different? Is there something new? How do you know? I've never been good at this. You know, I know what God's done by looking backwards, not ever looking forward. But I'm pretty good at hindsight. I'm really good. I'm really clear about what happened. Not so clear about what will happen. But if I was sure about what happened, I wouldn't need faith, would I? Neither would you. If you are sure what's going on, then you don't need faith. You don't need God at all. But sometimes God surprises us and he wants us to be in a place where we don't have all the answers. We don't have everything taken care of. We've talked a lot about, you know, when my stream went dry when I was in Minnesota, big church there and ministry and all those things, and then it ended one day. And we lost everything. We lost home, our friends, our church, our money, burned through our savings, retirement, lost our credit. I didn't know what else happened, but we lost our credit for years and all these things. And I was so bitter. And we kind of came back to Seattle, but we didn't get a word from the Lord. I got a word from Eileen. Let's go home. Let's just go to Seattle. And I went, why? It's cold there. She goes, not as cold as this. Not as cold as Minnesota. It's springtime. So we came back. And you know, those of you who were around when we first started this little church and growing, you knew that I was kind of bitter and everything like that. And wondering, you know, why God had abandoned me. And all those things I was going through. And but one of the things that happened when we first came back was I got an email from somebody. His name is Joe, who I'd known 20 years earlier, who was a very prominent businessman in town and entrepreneur and all those things. And he emailed me and went, "I heard you're in town. Could we get together for breakfast on Queen Anne at the Five Coins or something?" So,
Five Spot.
I went, "Wow, I've got nothing to do for the next rest of my life, but somebody wants to meet me for breakfast. I've got an appointment." Woohoo! Hey! And so the last I'd seen him, he was living large, had a big company down on the waterfront and all these things. And we started meeting. And he said, "Could we meet every Wednesday from now on, from 9 to 11. So we picked Tully's over by the Guild Theater and on 45th, and we would meet every Wednesday at 9 to 11. And I kept going, "Why are we meeting?" And then something happened in his life, and his business turned, and his finances changed, and he lost everything in the stock market deal, and he was broke. And then they found cancer in his neck. And he went through radical surgeries and cancer treatments. All through it, we kept meeting on Wednesdays, 9 to 11. And when he was in the hospital, couldn't come to Tully's, I'd go to the hospital on Wednesdays, and we'd sit there and talk in the hospital bed. When he came through the surgery, and realized that he was still alive, which was unexpected, still broke, but he said, "One of my friends owns a bunch of houses on Whitby and has offered me one for a few days on the water there, and I don't have anybody in my life to go there with me, so would you go for a couple of days with me to Whitby?" So we went. Actually, we got lost. I said, "I know how to get there," so we took the Edmonds Ferry, which doesn't go to Whitby. And we're driving all over, and he goes, "None of these streets are like the map the guy gave me." And finally, we went into a little market and went, "Do you know where this street is?" She goes, "It says Whitby." I go, "Yeah." She goes, "Well, we're in Kingston." "Oh, what do?" She goes, "Get back in your car and get back across the ferry the way you came, and then drive up to Mukilteo and take that ferry." "Oh, okay." Anyway, that was a side thing. But, so we're sitting there and we're looking out, and he's lost all taste and everything in his mouth. And so he's tasting. So I'll make him like one shrimp on the grill to see what that tastes like. And I'd make him one and he'd try it and try and see what things taste like. We're working on it, and I almost said bitching and moaning. I'm just griping and complaining. That's better. Griping and complaining about my life, and it's not the way I planned it, and what's going on, and what's God doing, and what's he thinking, and I'm going like this, you know. And he goes, "You know, John, if I would have called you up and said, 'Can we meet every Wednesday from 9 to 11, and you were at the big church doing your ministry and the country club and all that kind of stuff, would you have come?" Heck no. Why would I? I had a lot of things going. He said, I think that you had to get destroyed back at that church there and lose everything in order to come out here because you never would have met with me otherwise." Yeah, you're right. I never would have. And then I thought about each of us and different relationships. Would we be sharing our lives right now? No. It's only because my stream dried up. No, we're even here, you know. Maybe the things that have happened in your life where your streams have dried up, your brook has stopped being there and the ravens aren't coming anymore and you thought God was taking care of you and it's not. When you get in that situation, maybe that is the beginning of a whole new ministry, connection, life, that you might never have chosen, you might never have picked, but it's exactly where God wants you to be. It doesn't mean that the things that have happened to us weren't painful. losses that we've accumulated through the years were painful. They still are sometimes. But without them, we might not have taken the step to go to where we are now, where God wants us to be. Now, going back to what I said, I don't like letting go of stuff. You know, I drag my stories with me wherever I go, you know, except the good ones, I leave those behind. But maybe this is the time for all of us, each of us, to go, okay, what does God want to do with me now? What does God have for me now? Who are the people that I'm going to be the answer to their prayer? Who's waiting for me to come to the gate of the town and say, hey, lady, bring me a drink? Who's that in your life? We're not open to it until the brook goes dry. I think that sometimes these endings are really necessary. Yesterday I was looking around at different books and stuff, and I found one that I haven't read, so I can't tell you what's in it, but it was called Necessary Endings. And maybe that is what God's doing. We need to have our brook dry up. We need to have what we've been counting on, relying on, go away, as painful as that is, so that we can hear what the next step is. Is that scary?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do we like being scared?
No.
Hate it. Is it what God may have for us? Yeah. Chris told you we get to be in this church to Easter. Dang, that's not very much time. You know? This was our brook, you know? Came out of nowhere when we were in the pizza parlor and it's kind of been our place and da 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 da, right? We don't have to do anything, we got this. Woohoo! And now it's dried up. Does that mean that God's abandoned us, or does that mean our leaving here might be the answer to somebody else's prayer? We haven't even met yet. Who needs to be told, from our experience, you can trust God. God's going to be there for you. Took care of us, watched out for us, brought us this far not to leave us. I'd like to try something this year. I don't try good things easily. Unless I got nervous and walked backwards away from you. Disconnected. Oh, body language, that means nothing. So I'd like to try something this year. I would like to begin this new year without dragging all the crap from last year with me. And I'd like to invite you to join me in this. Maybe it's easier for you than for me, but wouldn't it be great to say, Lord, what do you want to do today? Who do you want me to see today? What do you want to have happen? Who do you want to bless today? And then have the courage to not do my usual thing, which is, well, that's not going to work because I've been through that. No reason to do it. Not to that. No. That is so 2016. I'm a hip 2017 guy. Lord, what do you want to do now? Let's do that. I think we need to thank God that those streams dry up. Because that just means there's a new opportunity. Happy New Year. Happy New Year. Happy New Adventure. thank you. Thank you that you provide for us, you protect us, you deliver us, you care for us, but you also let the changes come in order to provide for, protect, and to care for somebody else. So Lord, help us to see when we're going to be the answer to somebody else's prayer. And help us to trust you in the midst of it. And pass it on. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for, I'm saying, 2016. But Lord, thank you for today and what you have for us today. Help us not to miss it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.